be yesterday. I could have swore the same thing happened just the other day. Put on the spot, now what am I gonna say? If I tell them who you are, will they think that I'm insane? Do I really care? Well, yes, I know, maybe so. Cause if they don't think you're real, how will they ever know? So I will stop, cause even if they lie to me, it doesn't change a thing about what I believe. What I believe, yeah.
I don't care what it takes, I don't care who it shakes, I don't care what they say, I'm gonna do it your way. Even if I'm afraid, don't wanna make you love me. I don't care about anything, it's not about me.
You make me feel secure, you've given me your word, and now I know I'm sure. I was so messed up, like a way you turned around my face, when I thought you were just something up in outer space. But that's not the case. You're more real to me than what can make you out to be on the TV. Can you turn me up? Cause you know we're getting serious. When we talk about the invisible, it's clear to us.
No, it's not about you. Look at your neighbor and say, it ain't about you. It ain't about me. Amen. It's about the King of Glory. Amen. Hey, praise God. The Bible said in Psalms 133, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. And he said, wherever there is unity, there's a commanded blessing upon our lives. Amen. Praise God. And so I'm thankful tonight for Pastor BJ and Kingdom Life Fellowship joining with us on tonight and just worshiping God together. And we are just believing, as we have been doing, is cross-pollination and working with other churches, and that God is going to bring his body together. Amen? Amen. Praise God. And none of us can do it alone, but we are all the body of Christ. And when we come together in unity, God commands the blessing. Praise God. And so we're just going to worship the Lord together on tonight, and we're going to bless his name. And so I just want you to be joyful and happy and free. Amen? Amen. Praise God. And so if somebody don't look like they're having a good time, slap them. No, don't do that. But let's just enter into the presence of God tonight and worship him. It's good to have Driven over with us tonight and worshiping the Lord. They go there and go after God on Wednesday nights, but we invited them to come and be with us tonight. And aren't we thankful for another generation God's raising up? Amen? Praise God. So let's just stand together tonight. Father, we thank you tonight for your love. We thank you for your grace that you've shown toward us. God, you've given us this moment. You've given us this opportunity. And Father, none of us tonight are expecting, God, any tragedy or difficulty, but we don't know that we'll have another time that we can join together corporately and praise you, but we've got this chance. And so tonight, we will choose to lift up your name. We will choose to glorify you. Yeah. We will not hold anything back. We will not reserve anything for another moment, but we will give you praise tonight from the fruit of our lips. We will create an atmosphere that is conducive for your power and for your glory to dwell among us. And God, we give you praise and thanks in advance for what you will do in us tonight. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Let's give him praise tonight.
Come on, let's just say in your presence.
In your presence,
when I'm at
your throne, it's like fire.
Shut up in my bones.
In my bones, you're the one. The one that I desire, you're the all-consuming fire. In your presence,
when I'm at
your throne, it's like fire.
Shut up in my bones.
In my bones, you're the one. The one that I desire, you're the all-consuming
fire. In your presence.
When I'm at your throne, it's like fire.
Shut up in my bones.
Shut up in my bones, you're the one.
One that I desire.
You're the all-consuming
fire. In your presence.
When I'm at your throne, it's like fire. Shut up in my bones, you're the one. The one that I desire.
You're the all-consuming
fire.
Thankful for the presence of the Lord tonight. Hallelujah. How many of you know that that's the reason why we come? Is to experience the presence of God. Just say, there's nothing worth more.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord.
Come on, just say, I've tasted and seen.
I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone.
Your presence, Lord.
Your presence, Lord.
Come on, let's just sing it. I say, Holy Spirit, you are well.
Holy Spirit, you are well. Come in.
Come flood.
Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere.
Your glory.
There's nothing worth more. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope.
Nothing like your presence, Lord.
Your presence. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone.
Your presence, Lord.
Your presence, Lord.
Come on, let's just sing it out in this place tonight. Sing, Holy Spirit, you are.
Flood this place and fill me.
more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness.
Come on, just the voices.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness.
Holy Spirit, you are well. Come for this place and feel. Fill this atmosphere, Lord. Oh, we want to be overcome by your presence, only by your presence, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
He has Come on, here's the declaration. Our God is risen.
Our God is risen. He is alive. He won the victory. He reigns on high.
Come on, sing that. Our God.
Our God is risen.
He is alive.
He is alive. He won the victory.
Join hands with that one to the right and to the left of you. Amen. If you need to cross the aisles, do so. But let's just go in. There's something about touching and agreeing. Something about the power of unity. So, Father, we bring our needs to you tonight because you have already given us the victory. We trust in you fully and completely tonight in your lordship. We bring our needs to you tonight. We cast down every vain imagination and everything that has exalted itself above the name of God. Those things that nearly convinced us that it was greater than God itself. God, those things that we thought, God, were impossible. But God, in your presence, the impossible becomes possible. God, that which seems that will never take place, but a moment in your presence, you can shift everything. And you can cause that which has been working against us to begin to work for us and to accomplish it for our good. So I thank you tonight for it. I thank you, Father, for those who may need healing in their bodies tonight. We speak healing in the name of Jesus as we agree together in unity that healing is the children's bread, and we receive that healing tonight. Let your glory manifest in our hearts and in our lives. And let the fragrance of the rose of Sharon and the lily of the valley go with us tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. And amen, amen. Come on, let's give him a good praise tonight. Amen. Praise God. Well, you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Praise God. Appreciate you being in the house of the Lord tonight. Amen. As we were worshiping tonight, I'm reminded of something that I have written in the margins of my Bible. That is, true revival is a greater awareness of the presence of God. True revival is a greater awareness of the presence of God. God doesn't change. He doesn't get greater. we just become more aware of his presence. We become more aware and conscious of what he is doing in us and desires to do in us. And that's when revival burns in our hearts. Amen? Praise God. And so, and I believe that God is working something today to bring about the great awakening in this last day. Does anybody else believe that? One of the ways that the heavens will be open over our life and over our region and over the nation is through our worship. And in days and months and weeks ahead, we're going to be pushing in more on worship and more on prayer and intercession and prophetic praise and prophetic worship. And we're going to start that tomorrow night here at the church, 7 o'clock. We're going to go for 2 or 3 hours. We're going to worship the Lord. We're going to speak prophetic words into the atmosphere. And we're just going to declare God is working in us. And we're going to work as God works in us. Amen. Praise God. And so come on in. You know, I told you on Sunday, there's just something about being in the presence of God. Saul was not a prophet. He wasn't even right with God. But when he got in the presence of prophets, he began to prophesy. It's so, it's in your book. Amen. And so when we get in the presence of God, it begins to shift and begins to change us. And so we're just going to spend some time in his presence. Come in if you can at 7. If you can't, come at 8. But come sometime and just get in his presence and just bask in his glory and allow him to minister to you on tomorrow night. Okay?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. It's an honor to have with us Pastor Roberts, and he's been a dear friend of mine for many years. He and Tasha have ministered for us and always blessed our church when we were in White Sulphur Springs and then as well here. And we're thankful that we're teamed up with him here in this valley to just declare the kingdom of God has come.
Yes.
Amen. The kingdom of God is within us. And so we just declare that with liberty and freedom. And I'm honored that he would come and those from Kingdom Life that's come tonight. Thank you for coming. And we're just going to give an offering tonight. Amen. Praise God. And so our ushers are going to come and wait up on us this evening. And we're going to bless the man of God, the gift of God has entrusted to us on tonight. Praise God. Thank you, Father, for gifts that you give to the body. And the apostle, the prophet, the pastor, teacher, and evangelist. We thank you for the gift tonight that you've given and entrusted to us and Pastor Roberts. And God, we don't celebrate or we don't worship people, but we do honor the gift. So as we honor the gift tonight, we believe as we sow into him that there will be a release of what you have put in him into us. And so, Father, as he shares the word tonight, that it will not be laborsome, but it will be joyful. That as he leaves tonight, that he will leave restrained and revived. And Father, we ask you now that you would bless our gift to be a blessing to him in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you in your giving tonight. Now. do it one more time.
We are standing on holy ground.
It's holy ground.
And I know that there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now. We are standing in His presence on holy ground.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Will you help me welcome tonight Pastor BJ as he comes to minister tonight?
Thank you, sir. We look like brothers tonight.
Tell it.
Sounds like good.
That's awesome.
I love you, man.
Amen. Amen. You can be seated. I just told Bishop Matthews, I said, we look like brothers tonight. Same shoes and cuffs rolled. I guess great minds think alike. It is good to be in the house of the Lord this evening. And it's always good to come and be a part of the services here at the Tabernacle. It's a great church. Great man of God, first lady of God that you all have, that God has set over this house. And I have nothing but unbelievable respect and admiration for Bishop Matthews and Renee. They have been close to Tasha and I for many years now. He's actually, for Kingdom Life folks, he actually sits on our accountability board for Kingdom Life Fellowship Church. When we first started the church, I wanted an accountability board, and the very first person that I said I wanted on that board was Bishop Matthews. And tremendous man of God, tremendous spirit, tremendous preacher, amazing, amazing person. And you all have a wonderful gift in this house, and that God has placed in this house. And so we're thankful for him and thankful for his family. And and I know that I see their kids growing up and my kids growing up, and just make me feel old sometimes. I can remember at one point in time, I always used to say there weren't any little girls that like me, like little girls. Only one was Destiny. She, every time, she's just smiling. I mean, she was my buddy from like right here. It was me and her. And I said, I used to say, I said, this is the only little girl likes me. And I don't think it was till we had Amaya that little girls started liking me. I don't know. I guess I got the anointing for that. I don't know what it was. But it is a blessing to be here. And I want to thank all the Kingdom Life folks that came out this evening. Tasha and I have been in Columbus. We ministered at a church last night, and we had a good time there. It was a little bit of an extended service. We won't go as long tonight. Service was 4 hours last night, and so they didn't dismiss until right at 11:15, and so I don't think we'll go that long tonight, but that's not the anticipation. Sometimes you've got long services because the Holy Ghost is all over the place, and sometimes you've got long services because people just like to hear themselves talk. I'm just saying. I'm not saying people just want to hear themselves talk, but you know what I'm saying. We did have a good time, though, and we literally drove straight in and came here. Tasha's picking up some kids from basketball tryouts, and y'all know how all that kind of good stuff goes. So anyhow, let's get into the word of the Lord this evening. Turn to the book of Isaiah, chapter 61, verses 1 through 3. Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 through 3. That'll get us started, and then we'll see where we go from there. I'm not necessarily trying to tell you something you've never heard before. I think one of the things we run into many times in the church is we always want somebody to tell us something we never heard, and we're not quite yet doing what we already know. And so many times I think what we need is to reemphasize some of those things that we already know as believers, but are not applying. Isaiah 61, verse 1, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, and to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that He might be glorified. I'm going to jump real quick to verse 3 before we go anywhere else and just make this comment very quickly one of the things it says is the anointing will give you a garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Have you ever been in a heavy church before? And maybe some of you, I'm spiritually talking, you go into the church and you just feel heaviness in the church. I've been in those. I've preached in those before. I got an amen from the front row right there. I know, Richard, you've been in them churches too. You just feel heaviness when you start to preach. And many times I believe that the reason that that heaviness is there is because they need a good dose of the anointing of God to show up. Many times when you experience heaviness in church, it's because you have a group of people that have determined they know how to do church without the anointing. That they know how to make church happen without the Holy Ghost. We got this because, and I believe that is one of the things that we deal with in the modern day church, is we have become sophisticated and got this thing figured out. We know how to do it because we know how to welcome, and we know how to sing the songs, and we've got great praise teams and great bands and musicians and singers, and we've got everything that looks right. And really, it's a tragedy that you can go through a church service and not realize that the presence of God did not show up. I don't know about you, but I don't come to church just to go through motions. I don't come to church just to hear some songs. I can stay home and hear songs. I don't come to church just to hear somebody talk to me. I can turn on the TV and hear somebody talk to me. I don't just come to church for fellowship. Thank God for fellowship, but I don't come for fellowship. I can get fellowship at a basketball game. When we come to church, we come to church and we gather corporately so that God can manifest His presence, and so that there can be an atmosphere created that whatever comes into the house, when they come into contact with that atmosphere, it don't leave the same way that it came in. I can remember growing up as a kid and hearing the songs, particularly at altar call, but they would start to sing, "You won't leave like you came in Jesus' name." I don't know if any. I know I got young people in here, and I'm talking to some older folks now, but I is an older folk. I feel it. Oh, I feel old school in my soul all the time. And we would sing those songs, "You won't leave like you came in Jesus' name, bound, oppressed, tormented, sick, or lame, for the power of the Lord is still the same. You won't leave like you came in Jesus' name." When we come together because we come expecting God to do something amazing in the midst of the people of God. That we come with an expectancy on the inside of us to enter His gates with thanksgiving and enter into His courts with praise. We come with an expectancy, and we come not just seeing what the atmosphere is going to be like, but we come with the anticipation that if the atmosphere isn't right when I get there, by the time I show up, the atmosphere has to change, because I'm not waiting on somebody else to change the atmosphere. You've got something on the inside of you that can make hell tremble when you open up your mouth and begin to... We're not waiting on anybody else. I'm not waiting on someone to set the temperature for me. Sometimes you just got to go over to the spiritual thermostat and just set it on your own. And you got to make up in your mind, if don't nobody in this row going to get it, I'm going to get it. If no one else in this section is going to grab a hold of it, I'm going to grab a hold of it, because we didn't come to play. We didn't come to just see who's wearing what. We came for an encounter with God and God alone. If we do not experience the presence of God, there's no sense for us even coming. The anointing of God. It's the anointing of God that makes the difference in the service. The anointing is not a feeling, but it's something you can feel. It's not a feeling, because Lord knows if it was about feelings, about 3/4 of you would still be at home in your pajamas right now. You at your fuzzy slippers, your flannel plaid pajama pants, that t-shirt with the holes and food stains in it that you don't wear anywhere except for Walmart, and you cover it up with a coat when you go. Y'all got that shirt, don't you? I got y'all pegged. I know where you are. It's not a feeling, but the anointing you can feel. You can feel when the anointing of God just settles into a place, because you just feel stuff start lifting. You feel atmospheres changing. This is all of a sudden. And I know we talk about goosebumps, and it's not about goosebumps, but man, I'm telling you, there's sometimes something will just hit you right in the back of the neck, and it'll run down your spine all the way. I know we don't go off of feelings, we go off of faith, but I thank God we have a God that we can feel. Hallelujah, the anointing of God, the anointing of God. The anointing of God is nothing that we will ever be able to figure out in our natural mind. It is nothing. We can try to explain it, but the anointing is just like God. It cannot be explained. It must be experienced. You can't just talk about the anointing. You have to experience the anointing of God to understand what somebody's talking about. I remember years ago, I was working, when I was working construction, and I was on a job, and I was talking to another guy, and we went to church together, and we'd had one of them good, just barn-burning, Katie bar the doors, Holy Ghost all over the place services. And we were sitting there talking about the anointing, and this guy, he was saved, he was a deacon in his church, and we were talking about how the anointing, and he spoke up, I just don't know about all that anointing stuff. And I said, that's because you've never experienced it. If you would experience it, you would know what we're talking about. It's not something that you can necessarily explain as much as you have to experience it. It's just like God. I can try to explain God to you, but unless you experience Him, you're never going to know Him. You can try to explain salvation to someone, but until they experience it, your explanation is going to be futile. You can try to explain to someone what it feels like when you know the blood of Jesus has been applied to your sin and your name has been written in heaven. But if they've never experienced it, it's just words. The anointing is what makes the difference. Every situation, the anointing makes the difference. The Bible says that God is Spirit. God is Spirit. If God is Spirit, then it also means that God is supernatural. If God is Spirit and God is supernatural, then that means that whatever God does is Spirit and supernatural. Therefore, we will never be able to do what God has called us to do in any other manner except for in Spirit and supernatural. We cannot work this thing out on our own. We can have good plans, but if there's no supernatural on it, it's not going to work. So if God is Spirit and if God is supernatural, why would we imagine that God would move in any other way except for Spirit and supernatural? But the hardest thing about that for us is we've got this thing called a brain. And our brain is always trying to figure out
the supernatural. Y'all know it's the truth. How many of you, God, ever done anything spiritual in your life and the first thing your brain wanted to do was try to figure out how it happened? Or how many of you ever been in a situation where God was about to do something spiritual or supernatural in your life and you started thinking so much about it that you didn't give God opportunity to do it? Because our mind wants to figure it out. Our mind wants to know the ins and outs. Our mind wants to have it all written down. And so that way I know what's going on. But God is spirit. God is supernatural. Even those that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and truth. You can't think God. You can't theorize God. You can't worship God by your thoughts. You have to worship God in spirit. There is a purity that comes when we worship God in spirit and in truth. It bypasses your intellect. It bypasses your mind. It's where your spirit begins to commune with the Spirit of God. There's no interference. And all of a sudden you enter into this holy place where it's just you and God. You can be in a room like this and have people all around you, but at that point it doesn't matter because your spirit connected to His spirit, and all of a sudden something supernatural and special happened. At the heart of it all, we live in a society that wants that encounter. We live in among a group of people that wants that experience. They just don't know it yet. They've tried to experience it with learning. They've tried to experience it in social circles. They've tried to experience it everywhere else. But at the heart of it all, what they're longing for is an encounter with God. God is spirit. God. So if God is spirit, what God does is spirit, then the anointing must be a spiritual thing. The anointing of God is a spiritual thing. What is the anointing? We hear about it a lot. We hear folks talk about it. We say the anointing and we shout. But what is it? Number one, the anointing is supernatural enablement. Supernatural enablement from God, where God enables you to do something that you cannot do on your own. God puts something on the inside of you and enables you to take care of things that you cannot take care of on your own. And look, this isn't just all spiritual stuff. The anointing is not just for church. The anointing is for life. It's not just for Sunday and Wednesday. The anointing is for Monday and Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. God can anoint you to be a successful business person. God can anoint you to raise successful, holy children. God can anoint you to go to your school and see change in your school. The anointing is not just for church. It's for life. Every area of your life needs the anointing, supernatural enablement of God to do what you cannot do on your own. The anointing is the supernatural empowering to do. God will not anoint you to do nothing. The anointing will begin to flow when we begin to go. I heard a story one time about a woman that was praying in her bathroom. That was her prayer closet, was the bathroom. And she would pray in that bathroom. And one day she was praying, and while she was praying, she was asking God to anoint her. God, anoint me. Oh, God, I need the anointing. Lord, give me the anointing. God, I gotta have the anointing. How many have ever prayed that prayer before? But in the middle of that prayer, God spoke to her. And God said to her, that toilet doesn't need healed. That bathtub doesn't need delivered. I'm gonna let that sink in for a minute. Because it's easy for us to pray for the anointing there, but the anointing is not going to activate until we step into action. God will cause the anointing to flow upon you when you begin to do something. Just tell a couple of people, tell them, say, do something. Do something. Do something. Do what? I just do something for the kingdom. Do something for God. I don't know what to do. Start small. Do something. Just do something. Do you realize that the anointing is for things that you don't think you need to be anointed about? You may not think you need to be anointed to greet people at the door, but you need to be anointed. What are you going to do when the ushers are anointed and when people are walking through the door and they go to shake somebody's hand and God has an anointing on you and you give them a word of wisdom when they come walking up through the... Lord knows you got to be anointed to work in children's ministry. He didn't give me that one. And I didn't ask for it either. The anointing of God will begin to activate when we begin to do something. We cannot ask God to anoint us for the purpose of doing nothing, because at that point in time, it would be a waste of the anointing. The anointing is precious. The anointing is precious. In the Old Testament, they would make and whip up the batch of the anointing. They had a special formula for the anointing that could not be duplicated. You couldn't just make any type of anointing oil. You had to follow the specific formula, but it was precious. It was costly. It wasn't like some of us when we went to throw a dinner together and you just throw some stuff in the pot. Let's see, what do I have today? You ever cooked one of them dinners where you just like, let's see if I got something in the freezer? You pour it out, it got ice all over it. I can put some barbecue sauce on that, make it taste all right. Y'all laugh because y'all done it. I'm not talking about that kind of anointing. It took costly fragrance. Costly ointment. The anointing is precious. And when you come in contact with it, or when you find a church that the anointing is in, don't take it for granted. Because not everybody finds the anointing like you find the anointing. It's precious. It's precious. The anointing is not just for preachers. I know it's easy for us to think that the anointing is just for this. But the anointing is for mothers. It's for fathers. It's for teachers. It's for workers. The anointing is for everybody. Just say, it's for me. Do you realize when you get the revelation that the anointing is for you, it will even change the way you pray? It will change the way you ask people to pray for you. When you really realize that what God has placed within you and God wants to do for you, you won't need somebody else to always. You're not going to need everybody else to pray for you all the time. I'm sorry, I hope I don't make nobody mad. It's not my intention, but we've got to see as the people of God what God has in store for us. God's plan for the body of Christ is not for the body of Christ to rely upon one person for everything. God's plan for the body of Christ is not for the body of Christ to depend on one man to deliver one word and that's all you get for the week. No, that is not God's plan. God's plan for the body of Christ is for every person in the body to recognize what God has deposited on the inside of you And realize that when we come together not just to experience the anointing of one man, but you bring something into the house with you. And when you add what you have to what they have, to what they have, to what they have, then all of a sudden something special begins to happen and you begin to sow some things into the atmosphere. And so because you come in with it and they come in with it, if someone else comes in without it, they've got to get it before they leave, because there's a group of people that come with an expectancy that God is going to do something in the midst of the assembly. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 27 says that the anointing which you have received abides in you. It's already in you. Somebody say, it's in me. It's in you. You just got to know that it's in you. That anointing is not restricted by age. That anointing of God is not just for older saints. That anointing, I know even as a young child, I started singing when I was 7 years old at church. It was in those atmospheres I learned, even at 7 years old, what the anointing was. I knew sitting on the front row with my great-grandmother how to recognize the anointing. If for no other reason, she would start her little Holy Ghost laugh. She had a Holy Ghost laugh, and her hand would go up and she'd start crying, and you would hear her going, ooh, ooh. Ooh. Anybody having them grandmas with the Holy Ghost laugh? You know what I'm talking about? Ooh, ooh. And I knew the anointing was there. But I learned to experience it on my own. I could remember 7 years old walking in front of a pew with tears rolling down my face and my arms just going like this, because I didn't quite know what was going on yet, but I knew that something was going on. It's not restricted to positions. It's not restricted to title. It's not restricted to a particular age group. It's for everybody that calls themselves a believer in Jesus Christ. The anointing of God will flow in the sanctuary, will flow in the youth room, will flow in the kids' room. I believe when the Bible says that your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, it didn't put an age limit on it. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. I believe that when the anointing of God really begins to flow, it will be a multi-generational flow, that the older saints will link up with the younger saints. And I believe you're going to see 5-year-olds laying hands on 85-year-olds and seeing healing take place, because the anointing is flowing through the body of Christ. The anointing is for everybody. See, the anointing on your life is directly connected to the destiny for your life. The anointing on your life is connected to the destiny for your life. God anoints you to fulfill His specific purpose for you. David was anointed to be king. God anointed David. David was not the first choice, but he was anointed. David was not the chosen one by people, but he was anointed. David didn't look the part, but he was anointed. David didn't win superlative most likely to succeed, but he was anointed. David was anointed to be king. You must not get discouraged when you know God has anointed you to do something, but you don't see it come to pass right away. David was anointed to be king when someone else was king. David had the anointing to do it, even though somebody else was in the position. How tough would that be to know that God has anointed you to be in a particular place and someone else is occupying that place? How difficult do you think it was for Joshua knowing that he had been anointed to be the next leader of the nation of Israel, and that there was a promised land to go and take that God had already promised him, but he had to wait on some folks to die first. Joshua was a fighter. Joshua was a roughneck. I can promise you, there were some times Joshua was laying in his tent and I'd be like, God, I could go ahead and take care of about 20 of them right now. We can go ahead and go. God, there's just 20 left. I can, we're there. Sometimes the hardest thing to do is knowing what God has called you and anointed you to do, but you still have to wait until he says it's time. Don't let anyone tell you in the process of you waiting that for God to say it's time for them to tell you you're a failure. Don't let people tell you in the process of time that you messed up, because only you know what God has placed within you. Only you know when God gives you the okay. Only you know when God has told you, all right, it's time to do it. Because everyone else is going to look at it from the outside in. Everybody wants to be a spectator of your life. Everybody wants to look on the outside and say, well, if I was them, if I was going to do it, but guess what? They're not. You are. And only you can do what God has anointed you to do. And only you can do it in the time that God releases you to do it. And only you can step into it when God has called you to step into it. Can't nobody step into it for you but you. Can't no one else do it but you. Do you realize that God has deposited an anointing in you unlike anyone else on the earth? You've got things to do on your own that can't nobody else do but you. David, anointed to be king. Do you realize that when you know God has anointed you and you know what God has deposited in you, the anointing that is in you will speak for itself? David didn't have to go around and tell folks, I'm anointed to be king. That anointing spoke for itself. He didn't have to prove to anybody that he's anointed. When you really know God is anointed, you don't have to prove it to anybody. You just know it. And whether they like it or not, they can't do anything about it because it's... When you do what God has anointed you to do, the anointing that is on your life will speak for itself. That anointing that is on your life will silence the voice of your enemies. Because the fact of the matter is everyone that's been anointed to do something for God has always encountered some enemies along the way that's tried to tell them what God can't do or what they're not going to do. There's always been those. David, Lord knows, David had plenty of enemies. David had plenty of folks, enemies. Some enemies showed up in his own house, but David knew what he was anointed to do. And when you just keep doing what God has called you to do, the anointing that is on your life will silence those that are trying to put you down. The anointing that is on your life will silence those that are trying to put a stop to what God is trying to do in your life. The anointing that God has placed upon you will silence the voices of your enemy. How do I know? Because when God keeps blessing and God keeps doing and God keeps showing favor, they can keep talking, but it doesn't matter, because God is going to do what God wants to do. And they can try to put their mouth on it, but it doesn't matter, because God is the one that is doing it, not them. And so you just keep doing what God has called you to do and let them talk, because God is going to prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies. It was the anointing on David's life that kept his enemies from prevailing over him. It was the anointing that God had placed upon him. And no one was saying that David's perfect. Nobody is saying that David never sinned or that David made mistakes. But there was an anointing that was upon his life that carried him through the lowest times in his life. There was an anointing upon his life that when his enemies tried to kill him and should have been able to kill him, they still couldn't kill him, because God had placed an anointing on his life. The anointing anointing caused him to prevail over his enemies because it was God that had did it. It was God that blessed him. It was God that showed him favor. And when God shows you favor and when God anoints you, there's not a thing that anybody else can do about it except for just sit back and look what the Lord will do in your life. The anointing in your life will open doors of opportunity to show the favor of God that is upon you. That anointing that God placed upon you. Do you realize that when you understand what God has anointed you to do, there are doors that will open on their own. There are doors that will open up all by themselves that you don't have to kick, you don't have to push, you just have to just... It will open up doors and show the favor of God on your life because the anointing of God attracts the favor of God. The anointing of God, the anointing of God. We got to get back to the original text. I haven't forgot about it. I promise you I still am there and have it in my mind. But the original text that we read in Isaiah chapter 61 verses 1 through 3 said, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because he hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." Do you understand how powerful the anointing of God is? The anointing to preach, the anointing to bind up the brokenhearted, the anointing to proclaim liberties to the captive, the anointing to open the prison to them that are bound, the anointing to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. The awesome thing about this is in Luke chapter 4, Jesus read this. In the midst of the temple, in the midst of the religious leaders, and he says, this day... is this scripture fulfilled in your ears? See, that was a bold statement because they were anticipating this scripture having to do with the Messiah and they didn't believe he was the Messiah. And he said, this day is this scripture fulfilled in me. I'm going to tell you why this is important, because in the Old Testament, priests were anointed. Kings were anointed. Prophets were anointed. They even anointed furniture. I still anoint furniture. Buy a new car, I anoint it. I anoint my house. There are some times, and I know, so, oh, there's no significance in that. It's just the significance and the spiritual significance of it. I know some people get crazy with it and people get out of hand, but there's sometimes, look, there's been some battles that I've had to fight before, and there's times I've gone through kids getting just crazy sick, and you just go through and anoint every door in the house and the windows and plead the blood of Jesus and declare this house is covered by the... Jesus said this scripture is fulfilled in your ears. But see, that makes perfect sense when we go back to 1 John chapter 2, because at the very end of it, it says, talking about the anointing, it will teach you. And you will abide in him. So ultimately, the revelation of this thing now is the anointing is not a thing, the anointing is a person. The anointing is not an it, the anointing is a person. And that person is Jesus. This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. But here's the great thing about it. That scripture did not stop there. See, because you got to understand something about Jesus. Jesus' last name was not Christ. Some of you are going to get that when you get home. Jesus' last name was not Christ. Christ was used to describe who Jesus is. Christ, the Messiah. Christ, the anointed one. Christ, the one who has been anointed by God. But the Bible says that now, through the vehicle of the Holy Spirit, Christ now dwells in us. Christ now lives in us. And so when Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through, ultimately what he's saying is, I can do all things through the anointing. And that through the anointing, you can do all things. You see, when you got to understand something about the anointing brings a supernatural power into your life. It brings something and deposits something in you that you can't find other places and in other ways. But it is Jesus Christ himself empowering you, strengthening you, causing you to be what he has called you to be. And the awesome thing about it is this, is Jesus said, it's good for me to go. Now, if you were one of the disciples, that wouldn't make any sense. What do you mean it's good for you to go? These people around here are crazy. They're trying to kill you. They're going to kill us if you go. What are you talking about? It's good for you to go. But see, they didn't understand the real revelation of the anointing of God. Because Jesus said, I've got to go. Because when I go, I'm not just going to go, I'm going to send you me in spirit form. And he said, I'm going to go back to the Father. And when I get back to the Father, he said, I'm going to send the Comforter. I'm going to send the Helper. I'm going to send that anointing. And so Jesus was saying, what you have seen out of me in flesh, I'm now going to put that in you. And how I represented God on earth through the anointing that was on my life, I'm now going to be on the inside of you. And so that's why Jesus said that the works that I do, you will do also, and greater works, because the same Spirit that raised Christ up from the dead, if he dwells in. Do you understand the revelation of this? That when you have Christ dwelling in you, it's no longer you that live, but Christ that dwells in you. Do you realize that every problem that you face, you're not facing it as yourself, you're facing it as Christ. Every situation you have to deal with, you don't have to deal with it as yourself. You get to deal with it as Christ. When you have to look at sickness and face it head on, you don't have to look at sickness in yourself, because in yourself nothing's going to happen. But you look at the sickness as Christ. And when you understand that it is Christ that is in you, Lord have mercy, and you understand that it is that same anointing that raised Jesus Christ from the dead, the Bible says how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth, going about doing good, healing all that were sick, all that were oppressed, healing all that were tormented by the devil. Look, that wasn't just for one person, it's for you. God did not save us in order to leave us to ourselves. He saved you to empower you. He saved you to do something. He saved you to change folks. He saved you to change atmospheres. He saved you to go about. He saved you to go. He saved you to do. He saved you to be just like him. And everything that Jesus was on earth, you now are in the body of Christ, because it's not a different anointing, it's the same anointing. It's not a different spirit, it's the same spirit. And the same spirit that we read about in the book of Acts is the same spirit he has put on us. The same spirit that they experienced in the book of Acts, that when they came together and prayed, the place began to shake and they were all filled. Oh Lord have mercy. The same spirit that caused Peter to walk up to the gate and say, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give unto you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk is the same spirit that we have tonight. So why would we expect anything less than what we know God has promised? Tell somebody, you don't have a different anointing. You got the same anointing. You got the same spirit as Jesus. The anointing, the supernatural empowering of God for you to do what you cannot do. Let's stand to our feet, everybody. I didn't try to go deep tonight, but I need to encourage some folks because it's the anointing that makes the difference. It's the anointing that changes things. It's the anointing through the power of God that causes people to change. I want to encourage everyone in here to make Isaiah chapter 61 your declaration. Before I preach, I say this to myself. Some of you do it before you go to work, before you go to your school. I challenge you even right now, just say, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because He has anointed me. Let's close our eyes and begin to pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank You for Your word tonight. We thank You, God, for that sweet Spirit and that precious anointing. God, I thank You for every gift that is in this house, every gift in every person, every calling in every person, the anointing in every person. Even if they don't realize it, and even if they don't recognize it, God, it's there. God, I pray tonight that as Paul prayed for Timothy, we would stir up. That's what I hear. Stir up the gift of God. Stir up the gift of God. Stir up the gift of God. I believe even right now God is stirring things in your spirit. I believe God is stirring things up in your spirit even right now. You feel it churning. You feel it moving. Some of you, you're feeling some gifts begin to move that you haven't experienced for a while. But God is stirring those things up again in your life. God is stirring up some ministries that have been lying dormant. God is stirring up some things on the inside of you that you thought were dead or that you tried to push back into the recesses of your life. But God is stirring those things up by His anointing even right now. Whew. Hallelujah. Father, we thank You for that sweet, precious anointing. We thank You for Your Spirit. We thank You, God, that You have not called us to mundane, average, or ordinary, but You have called us to extraordinary. You have called us to supernatural. God, we refuse to be normal. We refuse to be normal. God, we believe tonight every gift, every calling will be fulfilled. I believe, God, that for the tabernacle of praise, Lord, there is stirring going on even right now. Leaders are being raised up. Ministries are being raised up. Whew, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's just lift our hands and thank God for the anointing. Come on, come on. Just open up your own mouth and begin to thank God. Begin to thank God. Out of the abundance of your heart, let your mouth begin to speak. God, we thank You. We thank You, Lord, every gift, every calling. We thank You, God. We thank You, God. Stir it up. Stir it up, God. Stir it up. Stir it up, Lord. Let the dead things be stirred, Lord. Let the dead ministries be stirred back to life again, oh God. Stir it up. Stir up the gifts tonight, Father. Stir up the gifts by Your Spirit, God. Stir it up. Stir it up. Stir it up. Hallelujah, God. Stir it up tonight. Hallelujah. 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 As Brother Jamie begins to sing and minister, if you feel God stirring, you feel that there's a freshness coming and you want to just come down to this altar area and begin to just pour out your heart before God, I believe that God is going to do some supernatural things for you tonight. Ah. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, if it's been stale, it's going to be fresh tonight.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
It's a season of power.
Hallelujah. Come on, sing it out, sing it out.
It's a new season. It's a fresh anointing. It's coming my way. It's a season of power. Prosperity, yeah. It's a new season coming to me.
Come on, let that be your declaration.
It's a new season. Yes, it is. It's a new day. It's coming my way. It's a season of power and prosperity. Yeah. It's a new season coming to me. Whoa. It's a new season, yeah. It's a new day, a fresh anointing is coming my way. It's a season of power. Prosperity. Oh, yeah. It's a new season coming to me.
Oh, come on, just speak that over your life tonight.
Oh, yeah. It's a new season. Yes, it is. Oh, it's a new day. Fresh anointing is coming your way. It's coming my way. It's a season of power, yeah, and prosperity. Oh, yeah. It's a new season. Coming to me. Oh, yeah. It's a new season. It's a new day. A fresh anointing is coming my way.
God. Thank God for the anointing. Destroys yokes and removes burdens for real. Amen. Praise God. And you know, appreciate Pastor BJ and, you know, the word of the Lord tonight. Sitting there thinking about it. You know, I believe in getting educated. Get all you can. I like to have more. But a lot of our problem is we've done got too smart.
Come on, that's good.
Amen. John G. Lake wasn't an intelligent man. But he walked into that Ebola camp and he shut it down. Amen. Told him, he said, what, how did you do it? He said, the life of God lives in me. Man, the life of God lives in me. They said, well, you know, and I shared this the other Wednesday night. I said, how does that happen? He said, get your microscope and get the Ebola virus and look at it. He said, make sure it's alive. They did. He put his hand under. He said, drop it in my hand. They said, you're crazy. He said, do it. They dropped it in his hand and it died instantly. The old church couldn't explain it, but they had it. Yeah. We can explain it, but we don't got it. Amen. Amen. But we need his anointing, because his anointing makes the difference in our lives. Amen. Praise God. Thank you again for being here tonight. Amen. Just encourage you, those, especially those, y'all, everyone is welcome, but our folks, we're going to be worshiping the Lord again on tomorrow night. So come on and let's press in on God, okay? Praise God. Father, thank you for your presence tonight. Thank you for the anointing. And God, we just pray, God, that we would walk in that. It would become a reality to us. God, that it would be more than words or more than preaching or more than talking or teaching. But God, it become a part of who we are, reality of who we are. And let us walk in that daily. And God, let us change the atmosphere around us, because of your presence that we carry with us. And we give you praise and thanks for this in Jesus' name. And amen. Amen. Praise God. God bless you as you go tonight.